The sun is out, the sky is blue, there's not a cloud to spoil the view, and it's time to dust off your pellet wagglers. If we go back a long time, we would use, this is as close as I could find, this is a handmade pellet waggler float with a popper on the bottom. And the poppers are used to stop it diving, and they used to say like it makes quite a nice noise. They do slow the cast down a little bit, as you can imagine that flying through the air isn't great. And they have got fins on, which are still adopted now on the top by many of the firms. What I would say about fins is they're great, well, it's still on a light wind, but in a strong wind, no matter who makes them, they do have a tendency to have a mind of their own and go not quite where you would want them to go. Floats, by and large, you can get them now, and I think very much to do with the modern day commercial angler at the top of the game is to cast as far as you possibly can, but get the float to land as silently as you can. And floats like this that have a weight that's pushed away from the body undoubtedly land a lot quieter on the water, but again, they're not the easiest things to cast and control because they do fly off at angles. But it's very much these days about getting the pellet in the water as quietly as you can. You know, the clear floats, I mean, these are super popular, available in every shop. They work well enough, you know. I've never been wholly sold that a fish can't see that, you know, even though it is see-through, but you can see them at distance and that's not a bad thing. But just always keep the float now as light as you can to get the distance you want. And if you take like an ordinary short peacock waggler or even a bolsa one, but here's one, I think this is one here. Now that's a loaded one, but you can get these like this ones, little short stubby ones, loaded or unloaded. Unloaded simply means that it doesn't have that weight in the base and you put shots either side of it. And when you put shots either side of the float and it hits the water, it's not going to dive as far, something like that. And if you imagine the fish are just feeding under the surface, you don't really want that float, and they dive a long way. You don't really want the float to dive at all. I mean, the art of pellet waggler fishing is to make it land really softly on the water. And most fish react to the pellet then as it hits, and you get a bite really quickly, which is why it's such a busy method in itself, but we'll move on to that. But to generalize on floats, keep them as light as you can for the distance you want to cast, but don't overstretch the float. You know, if you're having a massive whew, to try and get the float out there and you're still falling slightly short of where you need to go, just go up a size, because it's better to be where the fish are and maybe making a little bit more noise on the water than you want to, than to not be where the fish are. And obviously you need to go with the feed. As far as the feed, sort of four pellets always looks ideal to me, and they tend to group a little bit better. But the trick is to keep the pellet waggler like the furthest point away from where the pellets hit the water. That's the real skill in it, because the fish seem to back off it a little bit. And if your floats and your bait is in the right place, then you seem to catch more fish. Let's have a look at rigs themselves. And there are an absolute plethora of ways to tie your pellet waggler on. But let me show you three that I use and why I use them. Firstly, this one. So this is a waggler attachment one. Normally a little bit of fiberglass in there. I tend to just use a bit of pole rubber to push over the end. And it's slightly sort of concave in the center, and the swivel turns on that, and then you use the link swivel to attach your float. I tend to use these with sort of preloaded or pellet wagglers, because this little bit of fiberglass and this is sort of a bit of gubbins hanging around it. It does reduce the splash a little bit. It's quite good as long as the float's not too heavy. But if I'm using a loaded waggler, so say I'm going up against a wind or a side wind, loaded will cast a little bit better. That's my preferred rig for that. And also it does reduce the splash a little bit with loaded floats. Moving on up, we use the simplest one of all. And this is bog standard float rubbers. Normally I have one rod tip side of the float and two this side, just to stop it stop them sliding around, but they do sort of slide a little bit. But if you're fishing not very far out and little floats, they're very good for that. Also, if you want to add a little bit more weight so you get it really sort of tight to the tip of the float. These ones for me work a little bit better. You can run sort of shots up here a little bit, and they seem to work better like that. Maybe because these ones have got a prouder end towards the ring on the float, which keeps it nice and tidy. But that, for short range work, is my rig of choice. And this one here, it's a bit old school, and it's where the float is tied in between tram lines, they're called. There's two bits of line there. And at the end of the tram line, I tie, I sometimes twizzle it, but if you don't be bothered to twizzle it, you can tie a series of little loops, and that keeps the line really stiff and holds it out slightly. And I tend to use this float, or this rig rather, when I'm either on really big water, such as sort of Clatica or even Drayton, places like that used to be, where I'm throwing a big float a long way, because it's definitely not moving. It's not snapping out of that tram line, and nothing's, you know, so it is moving. It does give you a little bit of a bolt effect as well, but you'd also get a little bit of play. 9 times out of 10, it will go to this. So you have to the far, as a pellet falls, it'll go to the far knot and you're striking against that. But if you're using sort of 6 pound reel line, you're not going to break that. And it does help stand the hook length off a little bit. So if you're fishing 3 foot hook lengths, works really well. But for bigger floats and longer distances, that's my rig. The eagle-eyed amongst you would have noticed that we're not on the same lake. And there's a very good reason for that, is that as we started to fish, the fish started to spawn, and I'm not really in the habit of fishing for spawning fish, so we've moved. Luckily, here at Float Fish Farm, there are lots of different lakes, and we've come to the Phoenix Lake, which is quite interesting for pellet waggler, because there's a bit of a throw over there. We've dealt with bait, we've looked at rigs, we've looked at floats. It just leaves the hardware for me to have a look at. I'm itching to get started, so I'm going to start fishing right now. Since Nytro first came on the scene last year, we've tested a few of their rods. Firstly, we had a look at the Horizon, which were the rods that Tommy Pick used all last winter. And a few weeks ago, we looked at the introductory NTR models, which are composite rods with a commercial design. Which, you know, for the price, very impressed. This time we've come out with the Impacts, and these are again a commercial rod, but they are carbon rods, and these are not composite rods. They're a carbon design, and because of the weather and everything else, decided to have a look at a pellet waggler rod. Now, I normally prefer an 11 foot pellet waggler, just a personal preference, but I have to admit that 10 foot pellet waggler rods are starting to interest me, because they are incredibly light when they're carbon, and they're also very sharp on the pickup. So as long as you haven't got a cast too far, they're probably the right tool. Now here I'm casting, I don't know what that is. It's probably, you know, probably 40 meters. I'm trying to get up against the far bank. And the rod is handling, like, I'm only fishing, I think it's a 5 or 6 gram float. It's not particularly heavy, but casting accuracy, very good. But the line pickup speed is excellent. And this is not a 200 pound rod or anything like that. This is 44.95. So again, like Nytro, have really found their way into that sort of, it's not real bargain, but it's affordable tackle that's very, very pleasant to use. You know, I'm holding the rod and feeding and doing the normal stuff that you do with a pellet waggler. And I'm not the biggest guy, and I don't have particularly big wrists sort of thing, but I'm not having any fatigue. And yeah, so it's proving to be great fun to use. Now, I think with a pellet waggler rod, and I'll show you, I'll just unhook this fish and we'll pop it back. I think what you're looking for, and why they're made like they are, is, and they are starting to evolve. So years ago, you needed them to cast bigger floats, but not anymore. But what you're looking at is this shorter handle. That's about the right length for me. I certainly wouldn't want to see it any longer. And the reason that you have that short handle is because by its very nature, it's a busy method. You know, you're not putting the rod down. So like you pick it up, your pellet, you know, your catapult, because you need to fire your pellets out like that. And whether you're just casting or about to cast, you need to keep feeding and you put it down. And the rod needs to be able to move around the body very easily, you know, because you might want to sit on it when you're unhooking and stuff like that. So it simply doesn't work with a long handle. So that's why you need the short handle. I prefer my pellet waggler rods a little bit tippy, and this one is quite through, but it would certainly handle some heavier floats than this. I'm not sure what it's rated to, but I don't think you'd have any problems at all up to 15 grams. Line-wise on this particular rod, 4 pound is really good for pellet waggler because it casts nicely and it's got enough stretch in it to give you a fair bit of cushioning if you're after bigger fish. I think I'm on 5 here because basically it's what I had when I came out yesterday morning. But you could certainly fish for pretty big fish with this rod. But I think for this small type of venue, it's an absolutely ideal rod. And I'm not a huge believer in a 10-foot pellet waggler. Like I say, I really do like my 11-footers, but this one, at the moment, I'm really warming to. Anyway, let's get back out, see if we can catch another few fish. Starting to enjoy it now. I'm smiling because I'm really amused by the fish that I'm after. As I fed, the odd pellet goes across almost under the far bank, and they're the ones that they react to. And so now it's a case of stopping the float and letting the pellet flick beyond it. And if it goes up against the bank, you get a bite. But you know, that's the beauty of fishing. That's what keeps us all going, because you know, it is a bit of a game of chess at times. Anyway, let's deal with the fixtures and fittings on this Impax rod. We've got some pretty good quality standoff anodized guides. I like the standoff guide, and that is to mean that, you know, it sits away from the blank. And it sits away from the blank for a very good reason. That's because with float rods, when you're casting quite a light float, the line must not stick to the blank. So when it's raining or anything like that, you don't need the line sticking to the blank. So you need the guides that move, that are standing a little bit further off the blank. So that's what they are. So these are, they're all line guides. I wouldn't really ever advocate using braid with pellet waggler tactics, but these would be fine with mono. The build is an all carbon build, 24-ton carbon. So not bad build. We've got a really secure lockdown reel seat with a little nice little EVA thumb grip. Like I say, the short handle, which for me, you know, it's about the right length. I quite like it. I've got a nice little keeper ring, and the action, as you can see there, it's powerfully progressive, this rod, but pretty good for commercial carp. As I've got another fish on, it struck me that it can't be unmentioned that the Nytro as a company have come in low, but my word, they're hitting some high spots. I've looked at 3 rods in their range now, and I haven't looked at anything that is even approaching 100 pounds yet. They certainly have plans to do rods like that, but for the new kids on the block, if they continue to bring out rods of this sort of quality, because if you gave it me and blindfolded me this rod for £44.95, I'd probably tell you it was a 100 pound rod. So, but if they carry on like this, Nytro are going to create a real big bang